Hi, John here, and welcome to the next in the series on our heating update. This video will take you through the pre-installation work that I did and getting ready for the actual installation of the air source heat pump. To recap for you very quickly, the last video, which is up on screen at the moment, the thumbnail and the link to it, I talked about the fact that we have an old gas boiler. And it's since May 2021, it's been set at its lowest temperature to try to understand if our heating system could run at low temperatures. We heat our hot water with the immersion heater and excess solar via the eddi. These are some of the tests I did, just to briefly recap. So 24th of January of 2023, 0 degrees outside. And then I went around and took temperatures of the radiators, the inlet and outlet temperatures, to understand what the flow temperature was. The house was warm, so that was fine. If you recall previously, I talked about that we have 10mm microbore pipe work running throughout the house. Underfloor heating wasn't an option because we have solid wood floors downstairs, parquet flooring, and we obviously wanted to ditch gas. I'd also gone round and measured up every room and did my own heat loss survey, created a detailed floor plan for ground floor and first floor. We also had an EPC done, which is needed as part of the requirement to get the $5,000 grant from Ofgem off the price of the heat pump installation. And I also showed you on the last video the review of the professionally done heat loss survey by Mark from JMR Heating, who are the company who installed the heat pump. This shows you, just as a quick recap, these are the rooms where we're underpowered on heat loss. So the dining room being the worst room, landing was okay, and the rest of the rooms were at jeopardy, really. We needed to change the radiators in each one of those rooms. I had the proposal through from HeatGeek. As I said earlier, we went with JMR Heating and Energy Service, who are a HeatGeek assured installer. And we got the proposal through from HeatGeek, which is very detailed. This is what we've got, the AroTHERM, Vaillant AroTHERM Plus 7 kilowatt units, the Unistore 200 litre domestic hot water cylinder, the Senso comfort controls, and I'll show you the total price on the next video. It's the quote which I accepted, and this was the spec that they guaranteed they would work to. The bottom bit is really the key bit, the new renewable system information. So air source heat pump, Vaillant 7 kilowatt, and flow temperature 40 degrees. The heating scop is 4.13. And the hot water 1.75. So those are the annual performance indicators the system would work to. We had planning permission approved, which obviously would have been approved. It was a bit of a rubber stamp job, as I think I said in the last video. It was just a case of having to go through the motions. There was some caveats on there. It had to be in the location that you'd identified on the plan. Then had a message from Mark to say that 30th of June would be the start of our installation. This gave me about 4 weeks to sort of get things sorted. First thing I did was cancel our contract for our gas boiler. This is a full domestic and general loyalty customer type platinum level service plan, which covers an annual service up to £750 worth of approved repairs, nationwide gas service registers, and it covers all parts, labour and call out charges. And the price had gone up considerably because obviously our boiler had started to break down. So our annual premium, our last annual premium, would have been £539, which is actually quite expensive. So I cancelled that and instantly saved £540. I also then binned the instruction manuals for our gas boiler, recycled them, obviously, so we won't be needing those anymore. Boiler had been turned off since April anyway, but we were getting to a point where we would have a big space in the utility room where the boiler was, and this would be bricked up, the vent outside, and eventually the gas meter would be capped and removed. So I said about radiators, we've got 17 radiators in total, and all of them bar one were being replaced. So there's a quick run through the radiators. So the ensuite, master bedroom, walk-in wardrobe, the landing, and you can see by and large they're just single panel K1s or T1s, which is fine when you're dealing with gas because the radiators run a lot hotter, but for an air source heat pump they will be undersized. So lounge number 11, radiator 12, there's two here, 13 and 14, utility room 15, office 16 and 17 in the toilet downstairs. This is the radiator that we weren't changing, mainly because we couldn't get to it. I had some concerns about the microbore and spoke to Mark about that. You can see here that when they've fitted the microbore, they've bent it by hand, it looks like, and got a kink in it, so reducing the flow, which would be a problem with air source heat pumps because they rely on a good flow of water. Mark agreed that we would change the tails on all of the radiators and go to 15 mil. So keep the microbore, which is buried in the plasterboard, but come off that with 15 mil and plumb the radiators to 15 mil. I also thought, well, they're going to take all the radiators off, so they needed to be clean. And when I started to look at the radiators, look at the dust that builds up. It's amazing, isn't it? I did this last year and cleaned all the radiators. So within 12 months, they were sort of back to being really fluffy and filled with dust again. So round with the Hoover, the long brush to get rid of all the dust. Quite satisfying, actually. Even though I knew these radiators were going to be removed, well, I might as well start off with a clean sheet when they're putting the new radiators in. For the hot water, I said earlier that we've been heating our hot water via the immersion heater, controlled by eddi using the excess solar. I wanted to put in two of the sensors, the PT1000 sensors. Here's one of them here. I already had one fitted, but I wanted to put a second one in, so there's one in the middle of the tank and one towards the bottom of the tank. So it has a metal sensor, goes against the tank, and then there's two wires attached to that which go into a little terminal block, which then fits into the eddi relay board. Then it was a case of pushing in the second green clamp under the board, and hey presto, we ended up with two temperatures, top and bottom. And you can see there was quite a difference. I was quite surprised, actually, the difference between the actual temperature that we've been using, normally about 51 degrees, 50, 51 degrees is the temperature that we heat the hot water to. And the temperature at the bottom of the tank was sort of 20 degrees lower. It was quite surprising, this stratification that occurred. Other jobs that I needed to do, I wanted the heat pump to be on a LAN network rather than on Wi-Fi, which meant I needed to chase some network cables in the house. So I had my trusty Fisher tape out to be able to fish the cables through the house. I started with a cable run on the outside of the house, so I found it a lot easier to run network cables on the outside of the house rather than inside the house because I had to go through two floors. The switch for the network is in the office, which is downstairs, and then the heat pump controls would be upstairs in the loft. It meant running through the house, which was really quite complicated, and I didn't want to do that. And it was actually all on one side of the house externally, so it was a lot easier to do it on the outside. And while I was there, rather than just run one cable, I did two, so I've got a bit of backup. Initially I wanted to run it in the existing conduit that's there, but it just wouldn't fit. It was too tight with the two cables that were already in there, so I ended up running them down the side of this conduit. It was external Cat 5 cable, so it was quite fine being outside. This is up in the loft where it comes through at the top of the ladders, which are on the other side. And then this is coming out from the just by the power wall, actually, from the office, and then running around the outside of the house. So I did quite a bit of cabling while I was there, not only doing the cabling for the heat pump, but I also ran external cabling around to the television and one to the freesat box. So this is the office. Office needed a bit of a tidy up as a result of cabling and what have you. So initially it got a lot worse before things get better. There we go, all tidied up. So I'm no network engineer. It was the first time I'd actually done any networking of this type, so that was quite interesting. Knowing what bits to buy and how to install them, and so I watched a lot of YouTube videos and got the bits I needed to do that. So these sort of keystones, labelled those up. These are the back of the keystones that we just looked at, the cabling diagram there. I bought pre-fitted RJ45 cables where needed and tested all my cable runs with this cable tester, which was a bit of a godsend. This is in the office where I put in a 4-port plate. So there we go, studio, that runs out of the photography studio. Got one to the land of the Tesla Powerwall, one to the heat pump, one to the master bedroom, which is the television in there. And then I also did one to the lounge TV and one to the FreeSat box. I said about monitoring the heat pump. I wanted to make sure that we had a monitoring system in place from day one. So I purchased, and I'll put a link in the description down below, the open energy monitoring setup, which has a heat meter, which is that big white box with the bit of brass tubing in the middle. There's a closer look at it. So that measures the water temperature, the flow and return. Then got this clever box, which transmits the data. This is all the instructions for it. This is a device that measures the amount of electricity the heat pump is using. That fits in the consume unit. So that was all sort of ready, and I needed to do the LAN because the EMON HP box here has a LAN connection. You can do it by Wi-Fi, but it's better to do LAN. It's probably worth mentioning why I wanted the open energy heat monitoring system in place. It gives minute by minute data, second by second data, and it's real time, so you can actually look at how your heat pump's performing. So up on screen is a chart showing you the detail from the monitoring system, and I'll go through this in more detail in the next video. But you can see here, over between 6 a.m. in the morning and 7, this is running a heating cycle just to test it. We have a COP of 5.56 in this particular window, and it shows you the flow temperature, outside temperature, room temperature, electricity usage, blah, 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 blah. Compare this to, this again is our heat pump. When we did some tweaks to it, well, I say we, Mark, did some tweaks to it, and we found that it was cycling. Down at the bottom there, you can see those peaks where it's in and out, in and out, in and out over a sort of 15-minute window. And the COP there is 1.03, so it really affects the performance if you have a heat pump that's cycling continuously in a very short period of time. And this was just doing hot water, no heating at all. So that's why I wanted the open energy monitoring in place, so we could actually monitor the performance of the heat pump in real time, and the tweaks that we're doing in terms of setting it up and commissioning it and getting it running to its optimum, we can see how things are happening with the changes that we're making. So anyway, talk more about that in the next video. The other thing I had to do was to lay out where the heat pump was going to go. Another job I needed to do was clear out this sort of alleyway down the side of the house. It had this fence, which was a normal sort of lap fence, so all the panels, ship lap fence, I think they're called. So I changed that to allow a bit more air to get through. So put some of the shiplap panels on the one side and then some of them on the front to give a nice airy breeze. And it really made quite a difference actually to the airflow in this area. So we needed a good airflow. This is down the side of the house, walking past the chimney breast. All my cabling to the position where the heat pump would be. She's looking back the other way. And there's a good breeze down there now. And then looking up, this would be where the pipe run would be going into the loft and going off back into the airing cupboard. So there were all the jobs I had to do. Quite a few, actually. It's quite surprising how long that took to work all the way through that. In the next video, I shall take you through the install, that's not day by day what happened, and show you the final product once it's installed. All right, any questions, give me a shout down below. I'll pick those up. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next video. Bye.